my love.
Oh, that's
is
why
I really love the Lord.
And you just don't know.
Thanks be to God who gives us the victory in Christ Jesus. Victory.
That's why
I love.
Oh, that's why
I love.
Oh, that's why
I really love the Lord. Amen. Thank God for Jesus Christ, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. Thank God for Jesus Christ. It's good to be in the house one more again. See your smiling faces. I want to let you know that we recognize that everyone can't see the PowerPoint, and we have gotten back online. If you'd like, if you're sitting in the back or you'd like to follow along in the PowerPoint, you can do so by logging on to CrenshawChurchOfChrist.org. And clicking on the sermon notes, and you'll be able to have it right at your fingertips. You don't have to worry about advancing it. I'll do that. But you'll be able to see the screen. Even if you are sitting too far back, you'll be able to have access to it on your own. Y'all ready for another promise? I want you to find John chapter 11 for me. John 11 and verse, we're going to just look at a snippet of the story beginning at verse 17. John chapter 11 and verse number 17. Now, I want to run a disclaimer here that this text is rich. It's got a lot of good preaching in it. And if I were to go through every point, we'd be looking at this text for the rest of the year. I'm only going to do a flyby for our sermon this morning, all right? So if you say, Brother Tyson, you left that out? Yeah, I know, I left that out. So don't get on me if I leave your favorite point out. But there's a lot in this passage, and I just want to share a couple of points and really focus on the promise that Jesus gives us in John chapter 11. Now, y'all familiar with the death of Lazarus? This is that account. We're going to begin reading at verse number 17. The New King James Version of the Bible says, "So when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb 4 days." Y'all see that? Now, I want you to understand, in ancient Near Eastern times, even Israelites, Jews practice today, they don't wait around. When you die, you get put in the ground quickly. If you have Jewish friends, if you've ever been to a Jewish service, funeral service, literally the person will have died the day before. They have the service and then they bury them. So I want you to understand, he'd been in the tomb 4 days, which means he had been dead 4 days. Y'all see that? Now in our world, and you know, with black folks, you know, we let you sit around for a week or so while Big Mama and them get a flight and get to town and drive in from Dallas. Y'all know how we do it. So you might be sitting on ice for 7 to 10 days, but in the Bible, they didn't waste no time. They didn't waste no time. So when the Bible says that he had been in the tomb 4 days, I want you to understand he had been dead, actually, 4 days, all right? All right, that's going to be crucial in a moment here. So now Bethany, that's where they are, was near Jerusalem. The Bible says about 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had joined the women around Martha and Mary, watch this, to comfort them concerning their brother. Now we get our funeral and death practices right here out the Bible. When a person loses their loved one, we console them, don't we? We go to them. We get a bucket of chicken, or we go bake a cake. We go to Costco. We get something that we can take to the house because we're trying to alleviate their going through it by themselves, right? We don't want them to have to cook. Sometimes a person dies, you go to their house, family's around, somebody get to sweeping and mopping and cleaning because the family's so tied up in just the reaction to the death and making funeral arrangements, we don't want them to have to worry about anything. Well, in ancient Near Eastern times, when you lost your loved one, people would come to mourn with you. They would come cry for you. Now, I know we don't really practice it that way because we can come over to the house and not really show that we're down and out. We're just there to try to give our support. But support for them was that weepers and wailers would show up and cry with you. You might cry a little bit, but they would cry a lot of bit because they was crying on your behalf. So I want y'all to look at the scene now. Lazarus been in the tomb 4 days, and they still weeping and wailing and lamenting over his death. Y'all see that? All right, just want to make sure y'all see what I see. All right. All right. Verse 20 says, now Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went out and met him. But Mary was sitting in the house. Now, I want y'all to watch this. They already sent word to Jesus that Lazarus was sick. We're going to look at that here in a second. So Martha finds out Jesus is coming, so she goes out to meet him. Now, Martha, when she gets to Jesus, says to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. Y'all see that? Martha's understanding was that if Jesus would have made it back before Lazarus kicked the bucket, that Lazarus would still be walking around. Now, there is a little agitation in her voice because her thinking is, you could have answered my prayer if you had been here in the first place. Oh, I wish somebody was going to help me with this. See, there are times when we look at God and we'll ask God, why did this happen? If you had done this, then we wouldn't have this problem. Oh, I wish I had somebody was going to be honest. So sometimes we find ourselves in a hot mess and we talk to God a little upset with him that he didn't come through for us when we thought he should have come through. See, we wouldn't have to be here if God would have showed up a week ago. I wouldn't have lost my job. Amen, somebody. If God would have showed up a week ago, I wouldn't have made that mistake. But we get upset because we feel like, Lord, if you had been here. Y'all see that? But then she says, but even now I know that whatever you ask of God, God will give you. So she's a little agitated, but she also has some hope. Y'all see that? And Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Now I want y'all to watch this. I want y'all to watch this. She thinks that if Jesus would have been there, he would have kept her brother from dying. But she don't yet believe that Jesus can raise her brother from the dead. How you say that, Tyson? Well, Jesus just asked her, do you believe your brother will rise again? Martha ain't thinking in a few minutes. Martha's understanding is, well, yeah, on that great getting up morning when we all fly away over that celestial shore to meet the Lord in the air. That's what she's thinking. So I want you to watch this. She's asking Jesus for help, but she's unaware of just how much help Jesus can give. Yeah. Oh, Lord, I might as well extend the invitation right here. You ask for a little bit, but you're talking to the God of a lot of bit. Yeah. Just a thought. That ain't my sermon, but we'll get there in a second. Martha said, I know that he'll rise again in the resurrection at the last day. And Jesus said to her, now here are three promises in this text. I am the resurrection and the life. That's promise number one. Promise number two, he who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. That's promise number two. And promise number three is found in verse 26. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. And Jesus asked her, do you believe this? And she said to him, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. I want to speak to you for a few minutes from the subject, welcome to the good life. Welcome to the good life. Being a Christian has its obvious struggles. We endure hardships like soldiers. We fight spiritual warfare on the battlefields for our soul. We are repeatedly tempted and tried, having to prove day by day our obedience and love for the Lord. The restrictions can be chokingly painful, as there seems to be no fun for Christians. You stuck here now listening to a long-winded preacher when you know you're sleepy? You must endure the arduous task of dealing with your nosy neighbor who won't stop staring at you. Don't look around. You had to give up partying and drinking and fornication and my favorite, cursing, because you're getting older now and you're trying to get into heaven. We somehow believe that the fun for a Christian doesn't start until death, which we want no part of, at least for now. But brothers and sisters in Christ, we experience new life. We have what only God can give. We have the forgiveness of sin, amen, Walls. We have the fruit of the Spirit, amen, Walls. And we have the presence of an almighty God who neither sleeps nor slumbers. We have preached for so long what we can't do and what we don't have and how we shouldn't act that we don't even know what we do have, what we can do, and how we should act. Those in Christ are blessed with blessings that mere mortals cannot fathom. We enjoy this life now, not just later. We enjoy this life given by God, procured by Jesus, and sustained by the Holy Spirit. The gospel writer John paints a vivid picture of Jesus in a way that's new and exciting. As one of Jesus' inner circle members, John was privy to intimate information as well as the teachings that the other disciples had. However, his rendition of the life of Jesus reads differently than the synoptics. Y'all remember this from New Testament class? John sounds different from Matthew, Mark, and Luke. John lays out the story of Jesus in such a way as to see him as the true and living God, Savior of the world, and Redeemer of all humanity. Jesus then, in this gospel, is constantly pushing the religious envelope, rocking the social boat, and bumping the moral apple cart. With each challenge, he is ever so slightly nudging the religious elite to open up their minds to the Word made flesh. Thus, in the Gospel of John, we learn of the seven I am statements. In John chapter 8 and verse number 58, he told the Pharisees there that before Abraham was, I am. Jesus says that I am the door, and anyone who enters through him will be saved. Jesus is the good shepherd who gives his life for the sheep. Jesus is the light of the world, and those that follow him shall not walk in darkness, but have the light of life. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and those who come to the Father must come through him. Jesus is the vine, and his Father is the vine dresser. Every branch in him that does not bear fruit will be taken away. Jesus is the bread which came down from heaven. In our text, Jesus reveals himself as the resurrection and the life. The resurrection and the life of the new age is present right now because Jesus is the Lord of your life. I just want to say, going into our study, that we struggle as African American people with our understanding of God. Can I just get sound extra intelligent for a second? I don't want to scare nobody away, but I think it's going to be plain enough for you to be able to see it. We have inherited in America our understanding of Christ and of God through the lens of slavery. Now I want y'all to watch how this works. Because we are children of slaves, slaves were taught that following God was about delayed gratification. Stay with me now. I'm just going to use a couple of big words for just a second. Delayed gratification says that don't worry about how messed up your life is. I know you a slave. I know you get whooped. I know your daddy ain't around. I know we sold your mama up the river. I know we beat you and make you work for nothing. I know all that. But just keep on believing, and one day, Lordy, Lordy, when you die, you gonna fly away to be with the Lord, and the Lord is gonna bless you real good after we finish beating the snot out of you, raping your women. I wish I had somebody was gonna be honest with me. So what we have learned is that being a Christian ain't about enjoying nothing today, because we gotta suffer through this life. But on that great getting up morning, hallelujah, mercy, mercy, Lord is good, right? Well, I want y'all to know, Jesus is the Lord of the afterlife and your life right now. That you ain't gotta wait to have it good in God, because God wants you to have it good now as you trudge through this life. That you don't have to wait delayed gratification after you die to shout in the Lord. You got a reason to shout now. So what we have done is we have come to believe that in this life we got to endure all these hardships, and we got no help, and we just gonna barely make it through. And then when we die, we can have a party. Well, I want you to understand, in Christ, you got resurrected living right now. Amen. See, eternal life don't start when you die. Eternal life starts right now. Amen. Oh, y'all gonna help me with this by the time we get to this message. All right. As we studied previously, God will often allow us to experience various distresses, infirmities, needs, persecutions, and the likes, to get us to a spiritual place where we can see, understand, and know that He alone possesses the power to help us. Isn't that what we looked at last week? In John chapter 11 and verse number 1, we read that Lazarus, the brother of Mary and Martha, was gravely ill. The Bible says that Jesus knew and loved each family member, and that the sisters knew that He had the power to make Lazarus well. That's the reason why Martha said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." By verse 3, they sent word to Jesus that Lazarus was sick, and assumed that He would return immediately to restore their brother's health. However, the text tells us something rather interesting regarding Jesus and time. Look very closely at verse number 6. The Bible says in verse 6 that when Jesus heard Lazarus was sick, He stayed in the place where he was 2 more days. Uh-oh. Now, you just got word that Lazarus is sick, and you ain't gonna hustle back home? The Bible says Jesus waited 2 more days. In other words, He tarried, lingered, waited, delayed, loitered, remained, lagged, hesitated. My kid said like this, "Daddy, you're taking a long time." Some of y'all thinking that right now. But isn't it interesting that when we pray to God, we want Him to hurry up and answer? Y'all know that, right? We want God to hear our prayer right now and give us our answer 2 seconds later. But when He asks something of us, we need time to get our act together. We need time to fix ourselves up, get our minds right, work through some things, wrap our mind around the idea. And we need Him to be patient with us while we learn. Jesus' timing of this blessing in John 11 came from a heavenly view and not a fleshly view. The purpose for the situation is found in verse number 4. Can we read verse number 4 together? Jesus says, "This sickness is not unto death, but for the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it." Now, y'all remember last week, "Lest I be exalted above measure." Y'all remember that? From 2 Corinthians chapter, y'all remember that last week? "Lest I be exalted above measure, a thorn in the flesh," remember? "A messenger of Satan was sent to me to buffet me, lest I be exalted." Remember last week's purpose for the thorn? "Lest I be exalted above measure. He would go on to say, Paul, in the text, that the reason why he had to deal with his thorn in the flesh, this messenger of Satan that was sent to buffet him, so that God's grace would be sufficient for us, that his strength, amen, it is shown in our weaknesses. It is manifested or revealed in our weakness. In other words, God always has a purpose for what goes on, how it goes on, when it goes on, where it goes on, and for how long it goes on. Your trial may be longer or shorter based on the will of God. Your issue may be tough or light based on the will of God. Your issue might be up or down based on the will of God. Lazarus died. Mary and Martha are upset, but Jesus gives a purpose. This death sickness is not unto death, but there's a reason. What's the reason, Jesus? For the glory of God, that the Son of God may be glorified through it. So it's not going to stop hurting until God's purpose is accomplished. It's not going to get lighter until God's will is accomplished. It's not going to go nowhere until God's finished working that thing out. So instead of asking for God to remove that cup from you, we might as well ask God for the strength to swallow what's in the cup. Jesus knew that Lazarus's illness carried more weight with it than just a man being sick. Lazarus's sickness was the opportunity that God would take to reveal his awesomeness, his power, and his complete control over the situation. Think about it. God has a tendency to wait for just the right moment before coming through so that everybody know that he did it. Don't God work like that? So you'll know he did it. Oh, Lord, have mercy. You was getting ready, but the phone rang. Woo! He did it. You almost did that, but Lord showed up and showed up. Won't he do it? God have a tendency to wait for the last second. Well, it's the last second according to your time. But according to God's time, it's right on time. And if it's according to God's time and it's right on time, for you and I, it's going to always be in time. I wish I had somebody that was going to help me preach that. Y'all know he'll do it, right? Notice in verse 17, the Bible says that Lazarus had been in the tomb 4 days. According to rabbinical thought, here's the theology of the time in Jesus' day. The spirit wanders about the sepulchre for 3 days seeking an opportunity to return to the body. But when the aspect of the body changes or decomposes, it hovers no more, but leaves the body to itself. That's the thinking. Y'all know where we get the notion of awake from? Y'all know what awake is? Okay, y'all been in LA too long. I need some Southerners that can say amen with me. Okay, if you're from down south now, y'all know something about awake. And I ain't trying to tell, I read this book a long time ago about the practices of funerals and stuff like that. And one of the things I remember reading is if you go down deep, far enough down south, when they have certain traditions that they do. You know, when you die, back in the day, now I know this is going to age some of us, but back in the day, when you died, there was a belief that you really wasn't all the way dead. Because modern medicine, you didn't have coroners and doctors to pronounce you dead. So, you know, you had these house doctors and backwood doctors, and maybe they made a mistake. Maybe, you know, you just breathe slow, you know. Maybe you're unconscious, and the doctor may not be able to identify whether or not you're dead. And so if you don't move and you won't respond, and it may seem like you're dead. And so sometimes people were pronounced dead that wasn't really dead. So the notion of awake is that we got to come have a party before the funeral, and we got to make noise because the noise would wake. See, y'all didn't know that's where we got this from? That's where we got this stuff from. And so the notion was to have a party. Now, I know we don't like to hear that, but that means we get together and we make some noise because we're trying to wake up the person we think is dead. Now, back in the day, now you got to help me with that. I need you old school folk now. They would bury folk with a bell in the box. I know y'all I know y'all don't understand it. But the reason why is if we put Uncle Charlie in the ground and he's still alive, we don't want him to suffocate to death. So if he wake up after we done buried him, we want him to. I'm not making this up now. This is real stuff. Okay. In Jesus' day, we just read the understanding was that when you first die, your spirit don't go nowhere. It kind of hovers around where you are. And so for a person to be considered really dead, they got to be dead for 3 days. So day one, there's still a chance you might wake up. Day two, there's still a chance you might wake up. But on day three, they make sure that by day three, you show enough dead. Why y'all think Jesus stayed in the grave for 3 days? It was to prove that he was sure enough dead. Because if he'd have got up on day two, Negroes would have been like, that was just a trick. My uncle did that back in the day. Anybody could do that. They got my auntie on that. She woke up after she was dead 2 days. But by day three, you sure enough dead. Now, I want y'all to watch this. Jesus waited 2 days. When he got back, the man had been dead 4 days. Now, Lazarus is for sure enough dead. And the reason why is Jesus want everybody looking to know that this ain't a trick, this ain't hocus pocus, this ain't phony. He's shown up dead, his body's decomposing, y'all can smell his stench, but I am the resurrection. Yeah. And the life, and I'll bring him back with all of that. Yeah. All right. The friends of the deceased were in the habit of visiting the sepulcher for 3 days after death and burial, probably because they supposed that would be nearer to the departed soul. When the fourth day came and decomposition took place, as the soul, as they purposed, supposed, went away from the sepulcher. So now they beat their breasts and made loud lamentations, because by day four, they know that's it, and it ain't no coming back. This explains the illusion of the 4 days in the text. This saying, the saying that one had been in the grave 4 days, was equivalent to saying that the bodily decomposition had begun. Therefore, Jesus waited to show up because he wanted Lazarus to be all the way dead so that people would truly know who Jesus is. Didn't God wait for Sarah's uterus to shrivel up before opening it up? He waited for Abraham to pull the knife to kill his son before he stopped his hand. He waited for the furnace to get 7 times hotter than usual before he extinguished the flame. He waited for King Darius's lions to get good and hungry. When he closed Daniel in the den, then he muzzled the felines. God will take you to the edge and then manifest his power in your deliverance. That's the reason why I always tell folks, setbacks are just set ups for God's comebacks. Don't you realize that the more you paint it in the corner and you don't have no room, the more room God has to work? Oh, I wish somebody gave y'all reading a shout. Y'all didn't take me up on it. I said, when you down to your nothing, and your nothing is alone because it's by itself, that's when God shows up. Why your family still supporting you? God not gonna show up, because he gonna make you think, you will make yourself think that your family got your back. Then once you run out of favors with your family, you gonna turn to your friends. And you still think you making it because your friends is saving your hide. Amen, walls. Then when you run out of favor with your friends, here you come to the church to ask the deacons. Amen, walls. Amen, when you can. And you want somebody to save you because ultimately you think that this got to be of God because I'm asking the church. So I know the church going to come through for me. And there are times when the church don't even save you. And you got to sit and wallow in your stew for 4 days. I wish I had somebody that understood what I was talking about. And there's a tendency for God to take you to a place where you realize can't nobody help you but him. Because family is done with you, friends are done with you, church members are done with you, but God is still there. So sometimes when you see a person headed down a place and they're going to bump their head and let them make it, and you learn who God is in the struggle and in the journey. You just got to keep reminding folk, try God, trust God, love God, be obedient to God. And they keep making their mistakes. And they hear you and they shake their head, but they don't really want to do what you have to say. They're not really interested in trusting in God. And they keep bumping their head and bumping their head and bumping their head. And then one day, they didn't run out of favor with you. They didn't run out of favor with their family. They didn't run out of favor with their friend. And then they all by themselves and can't trust nobody but God. And then God come through. Then they come down front. We can't take the mic out their hand. They just praising God. I know God real. I know God. I can say, I know God is good. I know God is on the throne. I know, you know why they know so much? Because they had to get to a place where they knew he is the way. Amen. Don't keep people from learning that Jesus is the way. Amen. Look at what the Bible says in John chapter 9. Here's a purpose for us, even with the man born blind. Y'all remember this out of John chapter 9? That as Jesus passed by, he saw a man who was blind from birth. And the disciples asked him, saying, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Jesus answered, neither this man nor his parents sinned. That's not the reason why he was born blind. Well, why was the reason? What's the reason why he was born blind, Jesus? So that the works of God could be revealed in him. I want y'all to watch this. This man suffered through life not able to see, not because God was being mean, not because he messed up, not because his parents messed up. He was born blind. He was born with the inability to see so that God could show up and show out in his life. Woo! Oh, man, I think I can send an invitation on this one right here. Listen, 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 listen. I want y'all to think about it like this. When we have to suffer with stuff, there is a tendency for us to forget that God sees our life in its totality. We only get to see it one day at a time. Be honest with you, if God showed you where you was gonna go before you got there, we probably couldn't handle it. Because we'd be trying to manipulate and make things. I mean, think about it. If you knew the day you was gonna check out of here, you would live your life differently, right? Come on, quit, come on, tell the truth, shame the devil. Quit acting like y'all don't know. If you knew tomorrow was your last day, you'd be worshiping. You'd be in here so amped and high for the Lord. You'd be on your knees sweating. If you knew tomorrow was it, you wouldn't care who was looking at you. You'd rip your shirt off just praising God. Because you knew tomorrow's it. See, God don't want you to do it because you have to. He wants you to do it because you want to. And see, death looming means we have to. So if you knew you was going to mess up in 2 weeks, you'd take steps today to keep from messing up. So God don't only give you, only give us one day at a time. Only one day at a time. But what happens is because God sees our life before we do and understands where we're going, there's some turns we got to take in following him and some detours we got to take that you and I would never sign up to take. I mean, nobody wants to go through sickness for God's glory. Nobody wants to go through unemployment. Nobody wants to go through divorce court. Nobody wants to go through brokenness for God to get the glory. We want him to get the glory in another way, but we don't want to have to suffer. Jesus said this man's sickness was not because he messed up, but so that God could show up and show out. Jesus is getting ready to show out. Here's a second promise, and we're going to end with this promise, and the lesson will be yours. Jesus says, he who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. The second promise in this text speaks to our understanding of life, I must admit that I was a victim of uninformed teaching as a child because I believe eternal life was only experienced after death. That possession of eternal life didn't happen until death. I understood that in Christ, the blessing of eternal life didn't come into effect until you died. However, the gift of eternal life starts at one's birth in Christ, not at the cessation of your life. Let's look at what the scripture said. Can we stay right there in John? John chapter 3 and verse number 35. Bible says, the Father loves the Son, this is Jesus speaking, and has given all things into his hand. He who believes in the Son has everlasting life. And he who does not believe in the Son shall not see life. Now hold on. If you believe, you're living, right? So we're not talking about life like I was born from my mama's womb life. We're talking about eternal life. And if you don't believe, you're not even going to see eternal. Come on, somebody. I'm trying to give you some. Where my hellfire and brimstone folk at? I'm trying to give you some hellfire and brimstone. Outside of Christ, you don't know eternal life. That's the reason why your friends should be envying you who are in Christ, because you got something they can't even see. Instead, we envy them because they have possessions and they have fun and they get to seem like they are ahead. But don't you know that the fight is fixed? That we already done won? Jesus done already got on the cross. He done already gave his life. He done already got up. He done already went back to glory. He has the keys of death and hell in his hand. We have the victory. We are the winner. Amen. Now, I know it may not seem like it all the time, but we are the champions. I remember telling y'all a story a few years ago. Isaiah was playing ball, and we were at the party. He got his basketball team got to the championship game, and they won. They finished the season, I want to say, undefeated, and they went through and beat everybody. But when the game was over, our team was a little disorganized. And so although we won the championship, we didn't have, you know, any pizza party, ice cream after the game. And I remember when we walked out, my daughter got to looking at the team that we just beat, and they had pizza and ice cream. I mean, they just doing it up. I mean, just having a good old time. And she says, Daddy, I thought we won. And I said, baby, yeah, we did win. She says, well, why the other team? We got a tendency to do the same thing.
That's right. That's right.
Why they had a house on the hill? Why they get the good job?
Right.
Why they seem to have it all together?
Yes,
and I'm sitting here believing in Jesus and ain't got me nothing but welfare and EBD.
All right.
Whatever it is, y'all own it. EBT, I'm sorry. I didn't want to offend nobody, I'm sorry. But it don't feel like
we're winning. Yes, sir.
Because we're looking at what other people.
Yes, sir.
So there's a tendency not to understand you already got the trophy.
Amen.
Even though they're eating the pizza.
Amen.
All right, y'all don't like that scripture? I got another one for you. John chapter 4, verse number 13. Jesus answered and said unto her, speaking to the woman at the well, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again, speaking of the water in the well. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. The woman said to her, sir, give me some of this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. I want you to watch this. Jesus is talking about eternal life, everlasting life. John chapter 5, verse number 39. Jesus tells the Pharisees, you search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life. And these are they which testify me. The scriptures are only telling y'all that I'm him. You go to the scriptures thinking you're going to have eternal life and don't even realize that the one you're talking to is. Verse 40 says, but you are not willing to come to me that you may have life. Now watch this. They're living, but they don't have eternal life. Jesus is speaking of eternal life. Go on over to chapter 6, John chapter 6 and verse number 26. Jesus answered and said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him. Jesus is telling us, teaching us, showing us what eternal life is. For Jesus, eternal life was more about the quality of life rather than the quantity of life. In other words, it's not how long you live, but it's how well you live while you live. Many Christians believe that the good life doesn't start until we go to heaven, that our gratification in Christ is somehow delayed until we sprout wings and fly away. We have come to believe that the only good thing to look forward to is Jesus telling us, well done, my good and faithful servant. Whereas a future expectation of ceaseless ages is something to look forward to. I'm not downplaying that. We can live eternally in this world. Eternal living in Christ influences how we see this world and this world's issues. As children of God, we share a rich inheritance that we can use now. We possess it at this very moment. Wonderful blessings of God that neither rust nor fade away. Eternal life is defined by the special gifts of the messianic age, which is the age of Jesus Christ. When it arrives at its consummation, Lazarus' resurrection was a living parable demonstrating the future life available to those who trust in Christ. Martha, before her brother's actual resurrection, asserted her belief that Jesus would be raised on the last day. Jesus responded that he himself is the resurrection and the life, and that those who believe in him will never die, even if they die physically. Eternal life is the state of being in a permanent living relationship with God through Jesus Christ that begins and has begun in this life, and that will be consummated at the resurrection of the believers. That's the reason why Jesus prayed in John 17 and verse number 3, and this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true and living God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. For Jesus, eternal life starts with having a relationship with God. The reason why you ought to be obedient to God and the gospel of Jesus Christ is because at your birth, as a new creature in Christ Jesus, you come up now living, not on the fleshly scale, but on the divine scale, not according to the carnality of your flesh, but the divinity of your God. You are now living life eternally. In other words, we go from an earthly view to a heavenly view. We know that all things work together for good, that them that love the Lord and those that are called according to his purpose, even when it hurts, our eternal life lets us know that the suffering only lasts but for a little while, that weeping may endure for a night, but that joy comes in the morning. Your earthly view says this is too tough for me to handle. Your heavenly view, your eternal life view says, bring it on. I got some more. I'm not going to let Satan turn me around. Your earthly view may say, I don't have much and I can't do much, but your eternal life view says, I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. We got to start thinking eternally and not just based on the temporal. John would say in 1 John chapter 5 and verse number 11, and this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life. And this life is where? In his Son. Y'all see that? When you're baptized into Christ, you put on Christ as fellow heirs, as Christians, as believers, as baptized, repentant believers. We are in His Son. Eternal life is found in His Son. He who has the Son has eternal life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have. Y'all see that? Eternal life. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may continue to believe in the name of the Son of God. Let's land this plane. Do you know any people who don't experience that quality of life? There are people who are stressed, down, broken, and in despair. Children of God enjoy the love of God, the peace of God, joy in the Spirit, life in Christ, the hope of glory, the grace of God, and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And more importantly, and what we've been looking at is we also enjoy the power of Jesus Christ. Did you notice that Martha thought that Jesus would return to keep her brother from dying, and that after Lazarus died, she was disappointed that Jesus was too late? Think about what she says. If you had been here, although she believed that Lazarus would rise from the dead on resurrection morning, she failed to see that she was talking to the resurrection. Jesus's concern is to divert Martha's focus from an abstract belief in what takes place on the last day and redirect it to a personalized belief in Him who alone can provide it. Jesus said that not only, Jesus says He not only gives the bread from heaven, but is Himself the bread of life. So not only raises the dead on the last day, but He Himself is the resurrection and the life. There is neither resurrection nor eternal life outside of Jesus Christ. I'm done. I want to extend the invitation this way. And I want to start by speaking to those of you who have not made up your mind what you're going to do with Jesus Christ. If you're here and you don't have a right relationship with God because you have not obeyed the gospel, we beg you, get yourself right with God. And the way you do that is to obey and submit. Don't think you got to go home and clean up your life and then come back clean, because everybody in this room ain't clean. So don't think you got to go handle your business and get it all together before you come and get baptized. Jesus is the one who going to help you get that stuff in your life fixed. So don't think you got to do it by yourself. So I want you to understand, you obey the gospel by submitting to the will and way of God. The Bible teaches us that those who come to Christ, that God has given them the right to be called children of God. And we become children of God through baptism and rebirth. And I want you to understand, when we come to Christ, we do so in faith, meaning we don't have all the answers. If you had all the answers before you went through it, it wouldn't take faith. So the people in this room are just, we believe in God. That's all we can say is we believe that God will, that He can. That's what we believe. So you don't have to know every answer in the Bible quiz, Jeopardy, to be able to be a Christian. It don't work like that. It starts with faith in Him. Scriptures teach us that Jesus led a sinless life and died on Calvary for our sins. He paid the price, paid the debt we could not pay. But thanks be to God, He took His life back up again, and early on Sunday morning, Bible says that the grave rock was rolled away, and that empty grave proves that our Savior lives. You too need to be obedient to the gospel, to hear and believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God. Be willing to repent of your sin. Scriptures teach us to confess with our mouth that He's the Christ. We go down old and dead. We come up new and alive in Christ Jesus, living eternally at that moment. Remain faithful unto death, and heaven to be your home. That's for those who haven't made up their mind about Jesus. But now I want to offer an invitation to those of you who are Christian. I want us to be honest with ourselves. Some of the lives that we lead are pitiful. That's right. I said it. Ain't no judgment. Whatever you got in your world is, listen, there's moments I'm pitiful. It's sad. Because I lose sight of who I am. Because I'm so worried about what's going on around me. See, I have a tendency to believe that my marital problems are bigger than Jesus. I got a tendency to think that my hard-headed kids is bigger. I got a tendency to think that people in the business meeting in the church and the this and the that and the sermon, that that's bigger in some kind of way. I forget. So then I walk around with my lips stuck out because I'm complaining about the problems that I have when I don't realize that the one I pray to is bigger than my problem. And I will allow my problem to set the tone for the day instead of the problem solver to set the tone for the day. So because I'm focused on my problems, I'll walk around upset, mad, bitter, looking at you funny, jealous because I don't have what you have, complaining, won't count my blessings, won't appreciate what God has given until he take it away. Then all of a sudden, I want to get the Holy Ghost and be all happy in the Lord. When he start taking away the blessings that I wasn't appreciative of and start taking them back and recollecting them, then you want it back. Let's just start with air. You let your lungs close up. Bet you appreciate God waking you up this morning. Am I right about it? See, we don't realize. We don't realize because we will allow our problem. And that's not eternal living. Satan has robbed us of our joy because we're focused on temporal things. And I had to come to realize eternal living means that my possessions don't make me. No matter what my address is, I'm a child of God. No matter what I have in the bank, child of God. And that anything that I have is a gift God allowed me to use for a little while, and then I got to turn it over. Because your money not going with you. Them good looks, they're not going with you. So I had to learn that I need to start tapping into the blessings God has already provided instead of focusing on the ones that I think he hasn't given yet. Eternal life clicked in my mind when I realized that one, I have life, two, I have a family. They might be crazy, but they mine. I may not live like the next person, but I live, and I'm going to thank God for it. But I know one thing, that when it does get down and it does get bad, at least I know the Lord. Because other people who have certain stuff still got to sit on the front row when they people die. But I got the Lord. There's some people who they don't do really wrong. They haven't made no mistakes, but they still go through brokenness. But they do it without God. Even when I go through my stuff, I know I do it with the Lord. That's eternal thinking. So I beg you, if you're here this morning and you still waiting on that day to be excited about what God is doing, You are not tapping into eternal life offered to you right now. It's already been paid, already been established, already been given. We need to start thanking the Lord for what he's already done. And what he has done has been shown up good to me and to you. If you're here this morning, you need to respond to the message. We beg you to come right now.
Restore my spirit, Lord, I need restore.
God bless you, Gordon.
My heart is weary. Please help me, dear Lord. I stand in need of
more strength from your word. Renew my love.
My
faith, oh, restore my soul.
Revive the fire.
Revive the fire, Lord, deep in my soul.
Stir my desire.
Stir my desire to work in your
own. Light in my heart.
My heart, dear God, your zeal. Grown cool, renew my love,
rebuild my faith,
oh, restore my soul,
renew my courage, Lord, it is restored. My cup is empty.
Refill it.
God bless you. You may be seated. Replace all.